señor presidente de la Fundación de Amigos del Museo del Prado, señoras y señores, como el presidente del Real Patronato del Museo Nacional del Prado y en su representación, me honra que se celebre en esta casa el acto de homenaje que la Fundación Amigos del Museo del Prado tan acertadamente dedica al escritor John Ferrer para premiar su ejemplar trayectoria artística y literaria. El Salón de Proyección Internacional está considerado como una de las voces críticas más importantes del panorama contemporáneo. De la experiencia como artista y de la meditación que le ha proporcionado su infinito deseo de mirar, nace su reflexión en torno a la función del arte. Para Belcher, los museos del mundo son el lugar de confrontación con el misterio de la vida. Y en todo estado, sin lugar a dudas, es uno de sus grandes museos. Para nuestra institución constituye un gran honor haber tenido el privilegio de contar con las asiduas visitas de John Berger al Museo de Prado y sobre todo el placer de tener entre sus escritos el resultado de sus impresiones y la impronta que le han dejado las obras atesoradas en estas salas. Aunque su primera formación como pintor le llevó a ejercer como artista y como profesor de dibujo, sus condiciones sociales y políticas le condujeron a abandonar la senda del arte por la de la escritura, de la creencia de servir mejor sus objetivos a través de la literatura. Así para Berger, escribir se ha convertido en un modo de aproximación a lo experimental, sin por ello haber renunciado a su pasión por el arte. En su dilatada y multifacética trayectoria, tanto los programas de televisión que dirigió para la BBC a partir de 1972, los ensayos y libros que ha publicado sobre teoría del arte y comunicación visual inaugura nuevos modos de ver donde la mirada entre arte y vida se confunde. Por todo ello quería felicitar a la Fundación Amigos del Museo del Prado y más concretamente a su presidente Carlos Zurita, Duque de Soria, por la decisión de ofrecer este merecido homenaje a un hombre universal, el pensador y artista que ha sabido ver el valor de estas instituciones que llamamos museos y que no albergan otra cosa que fragmentos de multitud de impresiones, un fresco de la historia de la humanidad que nos narra el presente, el pasado y el futuro. Muchas gracias.
Señor presidente del Real Patronato del Museo del Prado, señor presidente de la Fundación de Amigos del Museo del Prado, amigos todos de John Berger, que celebramos hoy aquí, voy a leer un pequeño papel en homenaje a una persona que admiro desde hace muchas décadas. El retratista se enfrenta a la mortalidad del retratado, escribió John Berger en un ensayo titulado Cómo aparecen las cosas, o carta abierta a Marisa, dedicado a la pintura de bodegones. El paisajista se enfrenta al movimiento incesante de la naturaleza. El pintor de temas históricos al olvido de la historia. Y el pintor de bodegones a la dispersión de los objetos. Sus oponentes son el deterioro, el alguacil de barros y la almoneda. No se me ocurre mejor comienzo para expresar mi admiración por John Berger que estas cuatro líneas en las que logra compendiar algo, los géneros de la pintura, cuya explicación nos exige a los demás cientos de páginas y sin que se nos quite la sensación de que no hemos logrado hacerlos entender. Desde un punto de vista retórico, la capacidad de síntesis acredita un mayor valor literario. Pero desde cualquier punto de vista, la concisión es la señal inequívoca de una mejor comprensión de algo. Artista él mismo y durante un tiempo no breve dedicado a la enseñanza del arte, la rica y concentrada comprensión de esta materia demostrada por Berger, también a través de la escritura, no se debe a su condición de experto, una figura a la que los anglosajones gustan de referirse con el término de conocer.
Y que aunque tiene antecedentes que se remontan tiempo atrás, surgió en la durante la segunda mitad del siglo XIX, no solo para dotar de un talante científico la atribución de una obra a un autor, sino para revalidar la solvente seriedad de un mercado que ya entonces alcanzaba una dimensión económica muy notable y que no ha cesado de crecer hasta llegar a los niveles espectaculares de la actualidad. Con sus luces y sus sombras, estéticas y morales, el estudio del arte ha dado expertos memorables que han contribuido a elevar nuestra contemplación por encima de la mera erudición documental en la que se habían quedado atrapados los historiadores del arte positivistas. No obstante, si afirmo que John Berger no es en absoluto lo que normalmente se entiende como un experto, no se debe a que sea un indocumentado, ni mucho menos a que carezca de gusto, sino a que se ha negado a ceñir su relación crítica con una obra de arte a lo que ésta tiene como mero documento o como mera forma. Esto es así porque Berger no considera la obra de arte como un simple objeto, sino como un acontecimiento, es decir, algo que realmente ha ocurrido, como lo corrobora su forma material palpable, pero que no se limita a ser lo que es, sino que remite aún más allá de sí misma. ¿Cuál es entonces para Berger el secreto del arte? Yo creo, se contesta a sí mismo, que uno mira las pinturas con la esperanza de descubrir un secreto. No un secreto sobre el arte, sino sobre la vida. Y si lo descubre, seguirá siendo un secreto. Porque después de todo, no se puede traducir en palabras. Con las palabras, lo único que se puede hacer es trazar a mano un tosco mapa para llegar al secreto. Esto es lo que dice Berger. He aquí, de nuevo maravillosamente compendiado, cómo para Berger el valor del arte consiste en lo que tiene de representación de la existencia, mediante la cual el hombre se hace no solo consciente de lo que a él le pasa, sino de la vida en general y del papel, la responsabilidad que le corresponde en el cosmos, pero no como su explotador, sino, por así decirlo, como el guardián de su secreto. Adentrarse en el conocimiento de la naturaleza y el mundo, pero sin profanar su misterio, sin vana palabrería, es la misión del arte. Lo que en definitiva le interesa a Berger no es por tanto ser un experto en arte, sino profundizar en el misterio que su práctica nos transmite. No le interesa el expertizaje, el connoisseurship, sino lo que el arte condensa y nos transmite de la experiencia. Es decir, no lo que el arte tiene de forma y como forma, sino lo que las formas nos revelan de insondable sobre la vida. Hay desde luego muchas maneras de estudiar y clasificar la vida y la naturaleza, como nos lo demuestran las ciencias naturales. Pero interpretar la vida como descubrimiento, o mejor, como revelación del otro, lo que conlleva aproximarse al prójimo, eso es lo que le corresponde al verdadero arte. Para explicarse, no me extraña que Berger acuda al verbo ardiente de Simone Weil, de la que cita, por ejemplo, una frase esclarecedora que la pensadora francesa escribió en 1942. El amor por nuestro prójimo, cuando es el resultado de una atención creativa, es análogo al talento. Como el propio Berger nos advierte, aunque esta afirmación no se refiere específicamente al arte, incide en lo más hondo de lo que éste atesora y le da sentido, la compasión. Así se corrobora en lo que añade al respecto Simone Weil. El amor por nuestro prójimo es en toda su extensión significa sencillamente ser capaz de decirle: ¿qué te pasa? Por eso basta, pero también es indispensable saber mirarlo de una manera especial. Pero ¿cuál es esa manera especial de mirar al otro a través del arte que no elude lo físico y menos lo emocional? Aunque tampoco se refiriese con ello al arte, otro gran pensador francés, Emmanuel Levinas, escribió sobre este imprescindible y trágico encuentro existencial con el otro, pero añadiendo la determinación cálida de que éste debería producirse a través de la caricia. La caricia, afirmó Levinas, es un modo de ser del sujeto en el que el sujeto, por el contacto con el otro, va más allá de ese contacto. Se trata así, pues, añado yo, de mediante la caricia abrazar a la humanidad, con lo que de nuevo, cito literalmente a Levinas, la caricia no sabe lo que busca y es la espera de ese puro porvenir sin contenido. La caricia es un acto creativo, pues implica generosidad, sin la cual el arte no habría tenido lugar. Si mediante lo que hemos apuntado podemos atisbar de qué manera Berger entiende y se relaciona con el arte, no aceptaremos sin más ni más lo que dicen sobre su trayectoria algunos de sus biógrafos, sobre todo cuando afirman que abandonó su profesión primera de pintor y enseñante de pintura para dedicarse a otras cosas, como por ejemplo la crítica de arte y en general la escritura ensayística y creativa. Sé que dicen estas cosas para acreditar las múltiples capacidades que ha demostrado Berger en su fecunda y ya dilatada existencia. No creo necesario hacer ahora una relación de las mismas, por más que éstas resulten impresionantes. No obstante, cuando se ha adoptado la actitud de Berger, un cambio de perspectiva nunca es un abandono, ni mucho menos una veleidad, sino el imperativo resultado de prestar en cada momento más y mejor atención a la realidad, y hacerlo de manera cordial y compasiva, acariciadora, que es también genuina del arte. Pero en fin, estamos en el Museo del Prado y en el acto en el que esta histórica institución y la Fundación Amigos del Museo del Prado se han concertado para celebrar la personalidad y la actitud de John Berger. Quiero, por tanto, concluir mi breve laudatio con algunas notas sobre la estrecha relación entre Berger y el Prado y, en general, entre Berger y el arte español de todos los tiempos, porque siendo una relación viva, también lo ha sido directa entre vivos, con artistas españoles actuales, famosos o desconocidos. Porque Berger ha escrito, entre otros, sobre Zurbarán, Velázquez, Goya o Picasso, pero también lo ha hecho y con pareja intensidad sobre Miquel Barceló y Juan Muñoz. Pero como ocurre siempre con Berger, el asunto no es si ha escrito poco o mucho sobre un tema, en este caso sobre la obra de los grandes maestros que se conservan en el Museo del Prado o sobre el arte español, sino qué nos ha revelado sobre ello. Ciertamente es una hazaña imposible tratar de sintetizar aquí de un plumazo todo el rico caudal de sugerencias que nos ha proporcionado Berger al respecto, pero por lo menos permítaseme apuntarlo por medio de algunas reflexiones sobre Velázquez a través de las cuales logra caracterizar y ofrecernos una nueva luz sobre toda la pintura española. Berger afirma que el pintor sevillano, pese a ser un maestro de las apariencias visuales, era sin embargo un escéptico sobre ellas. Y aclara a continuación el significado original de esta escuela filosófica fundada por Pirro, que también casualmente había sido pintor, una actividad que abandonó para dedicarse al pensamiento, cuando escribe que las apariencias y la percepción, aunque importantes, son ilusorias y la verdad está detrás de ellas. Los primeros escépticos se oponían a toda explicación y solución, daban prioridad a la experiencia, la suya y la de los otros. Una parte de esa experiencia de la que se fiaban era que la vida era un enigma, un misterio que nunca podremos llegar a resolver. Es en ese sentido, continúa diciendo Berger, en el que digo que Velázquez era un escéptico, o más bien, un pintor escéptico. Hasta cierto punto, este escepticismo es típico de toda la pintura española. Siempre se define a la pintura española como realista y devota, mística incluso. Es cierto. Pero hay otra tendencia en la pintura española que se deriva de la convicción de que la verdad se encuentra detrás de las apariencias. Y lo que hay detrás de las apariencias es una gran oscuridad. En esa oscuridad habrá que buscar la verdad. Pensemos en la importancia de la rasgadura en la pintura española, desde Rivera hasta Tapies. La rasgadura en la carne o el desgarrón en la ropa. Las apariencias son vestiduras, incluso el cuerpo no es más que un ropaje. Desgárralo y podrás ver detrás lo esencial. En este sentido, la pintura española es escéptica con respecto a las apariencias. Lo esencial está detrás ellas, pero sin ellas no podríamos siquiera imaginar lo esencial. Con tan solo este apunte nos percatamos de que si Berger acierta en percibir lo que palpita tras el arte español, no es porque haya sido capaz de reconocer la excelsa singularidad de nuestros maestros, sino lo que estos percibieron de más profundamente humano entre los españoles. No ha reconocido, por tanto, a los españoles en sí, sino a la humanidad a través de España. Esta visión crítica del arte español no está al alcance de un experto, sino de alguien que afronta el arte en pos de la verdad que oculta, que es la insoldable suma de la experiencia histórica acumulada. Por eso me reitero en lo que he repetido. John Berger no es un experto, sino en todo caso lo que los antiguos llamaban un sabio. Muchas gracias.
Señor presidente del Real Patronato del Prado, señoras y señores, la institución que me honro en presidir otorga desde el año 2003 el premio Fundación Amigos del Museo del Prado, que agradece y celebra la labor y dedicación de distintas personalidades del mundo de la cultura por sus relevantes aportaciones a la comprensión y al conocimiento del arte. Nuestro objetivo es lograr un mayor reconocimiento público a quienes por sus obras o por su participación activa en el ámbito de la historia del arte, la crítica, la creación y la difusión de las ideas estéticas han contribuido al enriquecimiento del patrimonio cultural de España, con especial dedicación al Museo del Prado, institución que nos acoge y apoya y en cuya sede se realiza el acto de homenaje que acompaña a la entrega del premio. Hasta hoy habían sido homenajeados los historiadores del arte Francis Haskell, Enriqueta Harris, Julián Gallego, Nigel Glendinning y José Miliqua, y los directores de museo Alfonso Pérez Sánchez y Felipe de Montebello. En esta ocasión hemos querido reconocer las grandes aportaciones del escritor John Berger al conocimiento del arte, su innovadora y multidisciplinar forma de aproximarse a él, su lúcida forma de ver, su pasión y su original manera de transmitírnosla. Poeta, ensayista, novelista, historiador del arte, crítico y artista, John Berger, a través de escritos, guiones de películas o performances, ha revolucionado la manera de entender las bellas artes con una manera incisiva y personal. A los numerosos galardones recibidos por este creador en los diversos aspectos de su carrera, entre ellos el Booker Prize de Literatura en 1972, el George Orwell de Periodismo en 1975, o el otorgado por la Lana Foundation en el 2002 a toda su trayectoria, se unen ahora este homenaje y este premio, concedido por la Fundación Amigos del Museo del Prado, en agradecimiento por el inmenso legado de su obra y por toda una vida dedicada a la creatividad en defensa de la libertad y de la cultura. Nuestra institución ha tenido el gran honor de contar con la participación de John Berger en diferentes actividades desde 1977. De este modo, Berger ha impartido conferencias en varios cursos y colaborado en numerosas publicaciones, en todo lo cual ha mostrado su peculiar visión acerca de temas diversos como los de las naturalezas muertas, los detalles de los cuadros o algunas de las obras maestras que alberga el Prado y que le han marcado más profundamente. Como presidente de la Fundación Amigos del Museo del Prado, le hago entrega de este galardón, creado por la escultora Blanca Muñoz. En el título del mismo, Alrededor del Sol, podemos ver quizás la metáfora de una galaxia de infinitas estrellas que brillan del mismo modo en que lo hace John Berger en cada uno de los ámbitos en los que ha desarrollado su larga trayectoria, marcada por su pasión por el arte y por la vida. sirva este homenaje como reconocimiento a la labor tan meritoria que ha ejercido con entusiasmo y dedicación en la búsqueda y la transmisión de la belleza. Muchas gracias.
I'm not now indulging in a piece of flattery. I really do believe that the Prado Museum is unique in Europe. It's a very, very, very special museum. I don't really want to describe exactly how it is so, because you all know better than I do, or as well as I do. Its peculiarly great range, the quantity and richness of the work of several or well, many important artists, the concentration of those works, and not only Spanish artists. It seems to me that the Prado is actually like a city. It's like a city whose streets go through time and go through the centuries and across the continent. And if then there's that vast picture, I'll add one little tiny detail, very personal, that it contains what I think for me, just personally for me, is maybe the most sacred oil painting that I know of in European art. And that's the Antonello de Messina of the Angel with the Dead Christ. Tiny. Sublime. Okay, but let's come back to the notion that, the Prado is like a city with its streets crossing centuries. And this award that you have given me is, thank you, is like giving me the freedom of that city. Thank you. Okay, now, lying down to sleep. In that city, of course, like in all cities, there's an airport and there's a railway station, but there's also a bus station, the most modest. And what Katya, my daughter, what we again want to do is to welcome you into a bus trip. And you know where at the front it's announced where the bus is going. It just says, lying down to sleep. And I don't think, we know exactly where it's going. But come with us. Come with us. So, how to begin?
Let's talk about oblivion.
Oblivion? Is oblivion nothingness?
No. Nothingness is formless, and oblivion is circular.
What color? Blue?
Oblivion doesn't need paint. It sculpts. Oblivion leaves traces, like little white pebbles. Nothingness is before and after any pebbles or memory.
Nothingness wraps up life.
Oblivion is survival.
So is oblivion alone something lent by sleep to wakefulness?
No. Oblivion isn't alone from sleep. Sleep is creative, and oblivion grinds to the bone, penetrates, conserves, reduces to earth.
Maybe, huh? Maybe oblivion erases not choices, but causality. And we are often more mistaken about causes than about choices.
We are the precipitates of what our parents couldn't forget. We are what is left. The world and our words, like the ones
like
we are saying now, are what is left from everything that has been dispersed. To forget is to travel to the essence which remains, the stone.
Okay. Maybe oblivion is a warrant for the future. Why? Because everyone is everyone, but without recognizing it. And so, not recognizing it, they are condemned until they are modest enough to grasp this fact as oblivion. Everyone is everyone.
Memory and oblivion are not opposites. Together they make a whole.
Are the clouds in the oculo oblivion?
Yes.
A painted room.
Whose paintings
are addressed to somebody
who has just woken,
or somebody who is just about to go to sleep? So, this room is in the Ducal Palace, Mantua. The palace is a seat of power, even brutal. The room, by contrast, is intimate. It was conceived as a private room where the prince could receive visitors, and in which there is also a matrimonial bed. The paintings were commissioned by the Duke Ludovico Gonzaga and painted over a period of 11 years, 1460s and 1470s, by Andrea Mantegna.
When it was finished, it was said to be the most beautiful room in the world.
The bed was placed in the southwest corner of the room, So on the wall facing the foot of the bed is painted an outdoor scene with many figures in it. And it's entitled The Meeting, because it shows the Duke Ludovico meeting his son, Cardinal Francesco, and receiving a letter that his son has brought him.
On the wall facing the foot of the bed is an indoor scene of courtiers, in which the Duke holds the letter he has just received and read and is showing it to his wife.
On the ceiling above the bed is a painted dome which opens onto a painted sky. It's called the oculus, which means the eye.
The whole room is painted. We are inside a painting. The two other walls are painted, covered with floral decorations. And so are the curtains that frame and separate those scenes, and the pillars and moldings on the wall. Everything is painted.
All is representation. And we know they are painted curtains. We know they are painted figures, painted sky, painted hills. Everything is surface.
We might pull the painted curtain and hide the painted landscape.
We might open the painted curtain and see the painted landscape next morning.
Mantegna signed the painted room
and left his self-portrait
among the painted scrolls
that decorate one corner of the room, little hidden over there. Here, everything is both presented by and hidden in painting.
And so nothing is as stark as the body next to you in bed.
And as W.H. Auden wrote 5 centuries later, lay your sleeping head, my love, human on my faithless arm. Time and fevers burn away individual beauty from thoughtful children, and the grave proves the child ephemeral. But in my arms, till break of day, let the living creature lie, mortal, guilty, but to me, the entirely beautiful. So, what is the strategy of this painted room? How does it want to surprise us?
Mantegna was, is, famous for his innovations concerning foreshortening and perspective. Perhaps the most startling example is his dead Christ.
Remember how we saw it together?
Yeah, we lay down, one of them after the other, on the floor of the Brera Museum in Milan, before the dead Christ, to discover the probable eye level of the painter, and thus the ideal eye level for the spectator. The one of us on the floor acted the body, and the other one the painter. We wondered whether in the Mantegna the head wasn't slightly too large and the feet a little too small.
And mission accomplished, we saw that there was no error in the proportions, and that the painter was looking down on everything. His eye level the same as that of the humble third mourner, a little above the two Marys on the left. And one could draw a triangle between Christ's head, his pierced feet. It's strange how in the English language there is this echo between soul, the soul of a shoe, and the soul. That there's a triangle between Christ's head, his pierced feet, and at the apex of the triangle, the viewer's eye, coinciding with that of the third mourner, on the same level. That's what we discovered in the Breva.
Is there some kind of equivalence between Mantegna's preoccupation, obsession with spatial perspective, particularly in relation to the human body, and a sense of time passing, a temporal perspective? The little angels in the oculus painting with their... John, you must turn.
Rippling tummies.
You must turn it back to the oculus.
Yes. You've seen it. It's there. It's very, very. And there's their little rippling tummies.
No, it's me. It's Felix.
Yeah. And
the little angels in the oculus painting, where their rippling tummies touching their chins, with a tit tickling a lower lip.
You can see.
A pair of buttocks bursting out of a pair of shoulder blades just beneath a head of curly hair. Do they, despite their frivolity, have something to do with a vision of history?
Yes. Because his fascination for his intrigue with spatial perspective is inseparable from his insistence on a temporal perspective.
Look at the faces everywhere on these painted walls. Have you ever seen wrinkles, lines on faces better rendered? Have you ever seen painted wrinkles which are so alive, or rather, which have been so lived? I've never seen anywhere such a precise observation of the way time makes its mark on foreheads and eyelids, jowls and chins.
What time does to a face in any of the many portraits he made has rarely been delineated with such vehemence. Okay, with other painters it occurs, of course it occurs, but usually when the subject, the theme of the image is old age. But in Mantegna's painted faces, he makes us see the work of time, whatever the age of the sitter. And not surprisingly, among his contemporaries, there were, it seems, quite a few who were somewhat uneasy about being painted by him.
Now consider all the buildings in the landscape which we see through the arch of the fresco called The Meeting. They are there under the sky, one after another.
Yeah.
A tower in ruins, a tower being built with tiny workers on the scaffolding. Everywhere a remnant of the past and a plan for the future. Is this not as well a form of perspective? There is no other term for it. If Mantegna hadn't been a painter, he might have been an architect or a historian or a geriatrician or a midwife.
Mantegna, perhaps more than any other Renaissance painter, was devoted to and obsessed by the notion of antiquity. But for us today, to understand what that means, we have to make an imaginative leap, leaving behind modernity with its promise of continual progress. Let's make that leap.
There was nothing nostalgic in the Renaissance attachment to antiquity. Antiquity, with its models, offered a guide to achieving fully human behavior. It was exemplary in the strict sense of the word, insofar as it offered in its stories, its reflections, its art, examples of human wisdom, justice, and dignity. Examples which were to be followed, but continually risked to be forgotten.
The past offered rather more promises to the present than the future did. Or to put it another way, the more the world left the act of its creation behind, the more confused it risked to become. Unless it studied and learnt from its prototypes, which now had to be seen as archetypes. Mantegna had his own personal, private collection of antique statues. And he drew them, many, many, many drawings of them. And maybe these statues played a part in this fascination he had for foreshortening. Because, you know, with statues, you can move them around. You can turn them over, turn them upside down. You can very, very easily invent unexpected perspectives. You can draw them from any point of view.
Yet despite all this experience and observation, the standing life-size figures who surround the bed are inherently immobile. Right from the beginning, when Mantegna was recognized as a master, people commented on the fact that he painted rocks and human bodies in the same spirit, that for him, the existent was first and essentially mineral.
Yeah, yes, you're right. I mean, there's something very mineral in Mantegna's paintings. But I don't see figures being cast, molten from some gigantic cauldron. Not mineral in that sense. I see a stone or a metal surface, worn, dented, scratched, resistant. A surface reflecting all the different aspects of human experience, subject to the flow of time. As if for him, the four essential elements weren't air, earth, water, fire, but stone. Stone. Or to be more precise, metal, iron, copper, tin, gold. Tin.
The most familiar natural coating for Mantegna was rust. And since the 15th century, time has worked for him. Under his colors, there resided, even in the year 1500, and more so in the year 2000, the color of rusted metals.
Rusted metal, yeah. But not always. Not in the clouds and the angels in the oculo that you're remembering.
No, it's not worth it.
There is no place for rust. humans support both the weight of metal and its aging, its deterioration, and even a deterioration that brings a certain beauty. Mantegna painted the wrinkles, the lines of faces and their oxidization, revealed, yes, by that very special tint, that tint of rust, somewhere between green and orange. That tint that metals slowly acquire with time.
There's the color of rust.
And there's weight.
Metals are heavy. It's already white.
Yeah.
So it's okay.
Yes. And we can, and it's revealing. To compare, in this sense, Mantegna with Bellini, Giovanni Bellini. Yes. They were almost exactly the same age. Mantegna married Giovanni's and Gentili's sister, and they made versions of each other's paintings. They influenced one another, they competed with one another in a kind of way. Yet they were so different, Mantegna and Giovanni Bellini. Giovanni lived to the age of 86, and all his paintings, my grand one, look young. Not young in the sense of immature, tentative, derivative, but gently full of appetite, or appetites. Whereas Andrea, when he was a 17-year-old prodigy, was painting like an old man. What he paints is premeditated, patiently weighed up, measured. I don't know any other painter in European art who is older than him. Mm. There's a sculpture by Mantegna, discovered about 20 years ago. It's a standing, life-size figure carved in marble from somewhere near Padua. And it shows Saint Euphemia. She has her right hand in the jaws of a lion, who does not bite, but licks her fingers. She's 15 years old, young woman wearing elegant clothes. Her face is smooth, utterly unlined, and her expression is that of somebody waiting for the rest of the news that she is hearing or witnessing. Okay, she was a third century martyr from Asia Minor, near Istanbul. And she intervened with a local Roman governor on behalf of Christians who were being tortured and thrown to the lions. Take me first, she commanded. And her composure was such that the other victims became calm and refound their courage, the courage they'd had before. And the legend has it that when Euphemia was thrown to the wild beasts, they, instead of devouring her, made for her a hammock with their tails. And the expression on the sculptured head of this 15-year-old saint has, despite all that we've said, has something in common with the old man's look which I'm attributing to our painter. It has the same distance and attentiveness, the same concern for details, and the same foreknowledge about the end of all stories. A similar composure.
We saw her original statue in the Mantegna exhibition at the Louvre, Saint Euphemia. Determined and a little astounded, her hand safe in the jaws of a lion, jaws that are almost hidden behind the hand to which is done no harm. Her fingers, perhaps also the fall of her dress, attract all of our attention. But no, not all. My gaze wanders down to the spot where the two creatures, virgin and animal, really merge and come together. Their feet, the long toes of their 4 feet, so similar to each other, similar in their very being, in their strangely controlled wildness. And so I went through the entire exhibition at the Louvre, guided by a hunch, Mantegna being somehow fixated on feet. In Vienna, 4 centuries later, they could have labeled him a foot fetishist. Why feet? Because they say so much about standing upright and the human condition. They articulate, they carry, they transport.
They are the human signature at the bottom of the body?
At the bottom of the page. I went to look at Judith with her servant Abra. The two women have just come out of Holofernes' tent. Judith is handing the general's chopped off head to her old servant, who is holding an open sack. So on the left of the painting, one sees this man's head, long-haired and bloody. And on the right, a bed, on which one supposes Holofernes was sleeping before he was attacked. And on the bed, there is only a foot visible, Holofernes' foot. We see nothing but the head and foot of this man's body, and they are separated, the spiritual bit and the terrestrial bit, one celestial, the other mineral. Other paintings, which were not in the exhibition, come to mind. Above all, of course, the dead Christ, whose feet are in the foreground, as important as his head. I thought of his flying angels, whose feet and legs are so emphatic. I thought of his disciples asleep on the Mount of Olives. Mantegna, with his perspective and foreshortening, seldom missed a chance of tilting our verticality and thus questioning our priorities.
And his passion for antiquity often led him to put the past in front of the present and the future. The future, which is symbolized by all those buildings that take place in the background of his paintings. He liked to reverse the usual order of things. Head over heels.
Foot. Link between man and ground. Hinge between heaven and hell. Anchor. Plinth. Point of balance. The animal sign more distinct than any other. If I've counted correctly, along the very bottom edge of the two wall frescoes in the bridal chamber, there are 25 human feet and animal. A little behind them are more. The very frontier between the painted scenes and the lived-in room is lined with feet. Moreover, all the human feet, except those of the messenger from afar who has delivered the letter to the Duke, are without shoes, stockinged feet, dog paws, and a horse's hooves.
This bedroom?
Designed for a bed on which we lie down.
And on which we put our feet up.
So they are level with our heads.
No more weight. The heaviness of metal is behind us. The force of gravity is absent. Or, if it's still a little there, our backs are still pressing against the floor or the mattress. If it's still there, it's been transcended by a force of attraction, by the invitation to ascend.
Isn't the sleep which the room offers to the sleeper trying to do something extraordinary, to bring together the totality of a moment?
One moment.
With its relics from the past, its building sites, and all its different activities, its juxtaposition of daylight and nighttime, its plants, its animals in mid-movement, the degrees in social standing of all the people present, the details in their clothes, the expressions on their faces, their wrinkles, their whispered asides, their roving looks, and all of it, the whole of it, beneath a sky of little angels and a cloud.
The sleeper, the sleeper in this room can close her or his eyes on such a sight, reconciled with all the endlessly complicated layers and strata of the real.
And going to sleep, the sleeper will have around her or him the example, the demonstration of an artist who had the courage, yes, the courage, to consider and accept and include all those simultaneous strata. Mantegna, like a botanist who takes a specimen from all the plants he comes across, painted among these four walls, apricot, orange, lemon, pear,
peach,
apple, pomegranate trees, cedars, plane trees, acanthus, pine trees. Mantegna, who sets out to embrace the totality of what the world offers at a given moment. Only man separates and gives a pecking order to all these strata and processes and time flows. And the apparatus he has for doing this which forces him to do this is his ego.
His ego.
This apparatus, his ego, designed by nature for man as a mean for his survival, corresponds with nothing else in nature.
Yeah.
It's his most mortal part. When a man dies, only this part, only this chopping up apparatus disappears. Everything else is recycled.
Everyone
is everyone.
Last night, I had a dream. I was carrying a large shoulder bag, like postmen used to carry when delivering letters. I'm not sure whether it was leather or canvas. Probably plastic.
Plastic, I think.
Plastic. But in it were all Mantegna's paintings. 112. Not his frescoes, his paintings. And I was taking them out of the bag, one by one, to look at. And I was doing this so lightly, neither they nor the bag had any weight. And doing it with pleasure, in order, I knew, to come to a decision or a conclusion. About what? I didn't know. And I woke up happy. The oculus we are now looking at is not proposing an escape, an evasion. Mantegna, with his painstaking application, and yes, his lifelong courage, continually insisted upon facing the real, on not looking away from what happens. But what he proposed was dissolving into it.
There is in this room
decorated for sleeping in something of death. This something is neither rigid nor morbid. It's to do with the example of a painter who knew how to exclude himself bravely, yes,
bravely,
in order to observe the infinite number of events and moments which constitute the world.
Which constitute the world.
Mantegna counts them, adds them up obstinately, brings them together, and makes a whole of them, a sum total. He knows how to dissolve. He dissolves himself. He dissolves us in nature. And I dream here of closing my eyes for good, lying down within these four walls, which dare to sum up all that is on earth beyond human perception. The clouds in the oculo.
The clouds
in the oculo.
We go back there, put them down, and we just go back and bow to them. Someone.